Greetings.
Thank you.
Hail God Slayer.
Thank you.
Oracle, come here. Like yourself would be eager to see some explosions. Never mind why we're blowing things up just yet. We'll get to that. I've gone ahead and marked the locations of likely treasures and dangers. Consider me magnanimous. You can choose what we uncover, since I'm eager to see what kind of luck you possess. I'll wait back here, as far back as possible. Lay out a chain of devices. We'll make a mighty fine display. During the failed rebellion, I once called out with all my heart. An arrow was arcing through the air. My arm was pinned, and I knew I couldn't get out of the way in time. I was a dead woman. But luck answered my earnest request. Another arrow, also on a murderous path, hit the first in midair, and both were diverted, landing on either side of me instead. That was the first time I knew that chance itself was a real force in this world. I didn't say that. You must have misheard. During an unspecified war, I once called out with all my heart. An arrow was arcing through the air. My arm was pinned, and I knew I couldn't get out of the way in time. I was a dead woman. But luck answered my earnest request. Another arrow, also on a murderous path, hit the first in midair, and both were diverted, landing on either side of me instead. That was the first time I knew that chance itself was a real force in this world. I bet a yokel like yourself. I am honor-bound to discover the fate of Medvid and the druids of the Broken Circle. They believed they could see into the future by peering into the past. Hypothetically, that's a power I'd very much like to have for reasons of chance and profit. But I'm not sure I want it to be true. If Medvid and his nature mystics were right, and time truly is a circle, aren't we all doomed to repeat our lives over and over for eternity? If that is the truth, then there is no luck, no chance, no human will. All life is just a stage play repeating over and over. I don't think I like that notion. His final fate was unknown, but I do know he cast off his peaceful ways and trained with two powerful axes after he arrived here. We're not fools. We see that the dead rise here on Rayclast. If Medvid is still out there, he'll be extremely dangerous. Conserve your luck and use it against him if you find him. Never heard of gods, but I know I wouldn't put my faith in them, even if they came to my doorstep with an army. I've already solidified my beliefs where they belong. Stay lucky. As you can with the detonation cord. Further! Keep going! Away from me! All placed. Shall we light it up? I should also mention this might unearth monsters. You have taken. I grabbed for this job don't last long. Ha, yes. I could have been more upfront about the danger. But you see, people don't take the job when I mention that the upturned ground is full of deadly creatures. It's a mighty awful land you've got here, local. I wonder anyone survives at all. Though that does speak to why I'm here in the first place. But you'll have to ask Danig about that, if you find him. By the way, if you enjoy a bit of risk, I've got a few things I've unearthed that might be of interest to you. I'll finish up here. See you again soon. Yes. In a gambling mood? I'll finish up here. See you again soon. Now that we've a chance to talk without explosives and monsters around us, I'm Gwennon. Luck is my game, but it's no game. It's deadly serious. You have to believe you're going to win, or you won't. That's the nature of this life, understand? It is what you make of it. So when you gamble with me, know that it's your fault if you lose. You just didn't believe hard enough. Go well. Yes? Good luck.
To hear your poem.
The submerged passage. It's underwater again, and there's no sign of those shells you used to drain it. Fortunately, there's another way to reach Axiom Prison and beyond. A path I scouted out myself, through what was once the fetid pool, and then along the ridge above it. Problem is, whatever's brought those Karui revenants to life has also sealed the pool entranceway with a bloody great totem. The submerged passage. Farewell.
Hello, Exile. With Kitava now stomping around Orioth, it seems mythology is fast turning into reality. Then again, the gods didn't just spring out of some poet's head. I certainly couldn't pin an ode to the god of eternally flowing ale and then just stick me mug out to catch the free brew. No, I imagine the gods once dined, danced, and defecated just like you or I. Now they seem ready to take another stab at it. At life, I mean. Take the Karui father of war, for instance, old Tukahama, all comfortably tucked up in Kaum's holdfast, and playing war like a few thousand years was only a quiet weekend for him. Come to think of it, perhaps it was.
Good tidings to you.
Yes. From here to the beast, the journey is long and arduous. You are strong for a mortal. If the beating of this war drum shall burst your human heart. So we must fortify it with something a little more divine in nature. While a god may fall, their essence lingers, a quiet cacophony outside of your perception. That essence can be yours to galvanize your will and invigorate your body. I have the perfect first donor for us. Tukohama, the father of war. In a pool once foul and fetid, he has raised a fortress now ferocious and fearsome. Best you pay him a visit before he also raises that ugly son of his and unleashes him upon what remains of Rayclast. The Karui were a peaceful culture of farmers and fishermen before fate thrust the great Tukohama upon them. It was he who put the stone axes in their hands and the hunger for conquest in their bellies. Farmers quenched their dry fields in blood. Fishermen emptied their holds of fish and filled them with land greedy hordes. Battle by battle, war by war, Tukohama carved the steps that would carry him up a mountain of severed heads and into immortality. Tukohama's axe is called anger, his spear is called greed, and the victims are the minds and hearts of all Karui. Farewell.
Thank you.
made any pro. You do know it's cruel to make jests of an addled mind, don't you? Nessa, alive, and turned into a bloody cod. That said, you've never been wrong before. So seems like I'm going to have to stare this fanciful tale in its fishy face. She talked of the Brine King, did she? Now there's a name what can trouble the breeches of even the most jaded of poets. Though Mervale might be dead, the sea still has its seductive songs. And this time it's a big, briny baritone doing the wailing.
You've seen Nessa. Talk to her. Well, that's more than I dared hope for, truth be told. This change she's going through, this curse the so-called Brine King has put on her, it can be broken. I know it. You've got to keep going. Follow her trail before it gets any colder. Make your way along the coast, the ship graveyard, even Mervale's cave if you must. By my reckoning, this king's not the sort to venture far from his briny bed. The fetid pools lost its stink, washed clean like the autumn rain that gives Theopolis its only decent bath for the year. And turns out, when you scrub away the fetid filth, there's a Karui fortress underneath, probably built by King Kaum himself. Now home to, I don't even know what. Needless to say, I didn't get too close, but it looks like it's big, Karui, and right royally pissed off about something. Seems Tukahama's raised up a host out of whatever afterlife the Karui believe in. I feel for those poor bastards, if I'm to be honest. The Karui haven't had an easy history. Colonized, enslaved, used as pawns in many a war, and now abused in death by their own bloody god. This is why I don't follow any deity. They're all as bad as each other. Stay sharp out there.
Still composing that poem about you, Exile?
May humanity flourish.
Good tidings to you.
armor. The soil wants for your blood no more.
I am Sin, thief of virtue, and it is mine to take what I will from the defeated, to make a gift of it to the victorious. Alas, your mortal frame cannot withstand the unfettered fire of deism. It would turn your blood to mist and scorch your precious flesh black. So choose modestly and choose wisely, for there is much more at stake here than your little hopes and dreams. Remember, humanity needs us.
That was thee, Tokohama? Best not mention this to the Karui.
Yes?
I could hardly hope for better results.
Good tidings to you. Time and tide wait for no man.
You've killed the Karui war god. Can you kill a god? Look, I can't even begin to understand what you've just done. Mestil will be able to put our gratitude into words more fitting of a legend. Me, I'll work with what I know. A solid reward for a damn fine deed. Axiom Prison has been fairly quiet since he saw fit to retire its warden. Afraid that's no longer the case. Chavron of Umbra, the very witch that made Brutus the man he was. I don't know if she's a ghost, a ghoul, or some other death-scorning creature I've never heard of, but she's up there, tinkering away with her black arts and twisting nature around her bony old fingers. Honestly, I don't care why she's come back or what cruelty she's brewing up there. She's a boil that needs lancing before the infection spreads. Stay sharp out there.
Still composing that poem about you, Exile? Screams, howls and booms of unholy intonation. The shriek and clank of some unfathomable apparatus, and the pervading stench of scorched flesh and boiling blood. That's Axiom Prison, now that Our Lady of Umbra has come home to roost. As a poet, I have nothing against a little creativity. Yet while I might mold word and wonder, Chavron's art tends towards the visceral, flesh, bone, and soul. Artistic pursuit is the loftiest of callings, but in this instance, I believe some rigorous criticism is in order.
Good tidings to you.
Yes?
rather well.
Come on now, don't go all day. Name's Tujin. You're to do the dirty work while we do the digging. It's as good an alliance as any. Well, let's up to it. I'm of a particular purpose, see? I'm scratching up the ground in search of an ancient rowdy band. They were called the Black Scythe Mercenaries. Their founder, a particularly heroic warrior by the name of Varana, shares ties to my bloodline. Before I can go home, I need to find out what happened to her. She was a fearsome and irrepressible warrior. King Cadogan III tried to mandate her service to the crown, but she laid flat every man sent to bring her in. Eventually, he realized that she couldn't be controlled, and he gave her a mercenary charter instead. Given the freedom to operate the way she wanted. She won many great victories for the Kalgur. I respect those who make their own way. Her fate here on Rayclass was unknown, but I have a feeling she's still kicking about. A burning spirit like that never goes down without a legendary fight. We're a proud people, but aren't they all? Difference is, we labour against the grim realities of life through the judicious application of bravery and courage. One's lineage carries an ongoing tally of renown and accomplishment. We do this not for ourselves, but for our children, should we one day have him. He's open. She's a distant cousin of mine, so I do what I can to protect her. Got some weird ideas about the world, though. Thinks belief can shape events. If it could, we wouldn't have been defeated during our last campaign. Wash your back. For me to lose another limb, are ya? What do you need?
I believe in traveling light.
Greetings to you. Tide wait for no man. Tidings. Time and tide wait for no man.
charge you need.
There's a lady in a tower, but this is no fairy tale.
Thank you.
the court of the goddess, every man and woman is deemed worthy of redemption. Though you might be shackled by the tribulations of the past, the trials ahead offer you both freedom and glory. The future is yours, if you're bold enough to reach out for it.
I believe in traveling light.
Good tidings to you. For no man. tidings to you. Time and tide wait for no man.
Need something? We've campaigned together for many years. It's taken a great toll on him, but he soldiers on. I don't know how he remains so cheery, honestly. If he loses another limb, he'll be more metal than man. Go well.
What do you need?
I'm Rog. Gwennon said you'd be heading this way. Said you got quite the moves. You're the kind of man that faces monsters with bravery and skill, are you? I prefer to avoid fighting myself. This continent is fraught with danger. I specialize in logistics and planning, so I'm happy to support your fighting with my supply skills. Care to check out some of my deals? I'm bound by honor to discover the fate of Uhtred and the Order of the Chalice. I'll trade you for any relics that you find with their marks and runes. They were the primary priesthood and religious order that went with the initial ships to Rayclast. They interpreted the stars and the workings of mysterious forces such as alchemy, machinery, and runes. I've always wanted to join the Order. I quite like the idea of spending my days sequestered in a laboratory doing research. Thousands of years ago, the last news coming back to the homeland painted Uhtred in quite the negative light. Some called him a traitor, but the details were sparse and confused. I'm here to clear his name or condemn him. The truth stands above all. He's as loyal a friend as you'll ever find. He would never admit this, but all his scars and injuries are the result of diving in to take a blow for one of us. By all rights, Gwennon should be half mauled, and I should be missing a leg, but Tujin leapt between. I only feel safe enough to do my job because he's around. She'll never lie to you, Exile. Take that as you will. Don't eat the mushrooms. Seems risky. Thank you.
I believe in traveling light.
Hail.
Hail? He's a sweetheart. Have you seen the figurines he carves? The four of us use them to play this delightfully strange game he came up with. I love it because there are so many dice rolls and, well, you know me. Stay lucky.
Aye.
Many a campaign would have failed if not for his logistical skills. We've trekked through mud, rain, snow and sand, and yet eaten heartily throughout. It's the true basis of war, mind you, logistics. Don't think we don't know that. Don't give up.
Need something?
Good tidings, team. Time and tide wait for no man. Good tidings, team. Tide, wait for no man. Good tidings to you. Time and tide, wait for no man.
Glad to see.
Thank you.
suffer this humiliation again!
It's a pleasure, milady.
And so it begins. My ethereal veins now run with dark ambition. Let's turn that trickle into a torrent. Let's harvest ourselves a Grand Inquisitor. Just as Chevron's spirit chose to return to comfortable climes, Meligara's essence once again dwells in his very own chamber of sins. Though I hasten to add that Meligara's sins are not my sins. I prefer transgressions of a more natural order than does he. I'd carry you to Freesia if I could, yet I expended too much of myself when I snatched you from the jaws of Kitava. You'll need to find your own path, as will I. Make the journey, and please survive it. We too have much work left to do. And so it begins. And so it begins.
This world is dull and ugly. An imperfect feast of sights, feelings, and smells that repulse and depress. Yet amongst this deformity, I have found my sublime calling. This world may be abominable, but to an extent, I can be its savior. I have been gifted with a special sight. Before me lies a blueprint of perfection, a kind of hidden beauty within skin, muscles, tendons, and organs. With a tempered hand and a sharpened blade, I will refashion, reshape, and rebirth this world. My obligation is immense, something that will, in all likelihood, consume my life. I cannot rest. My calling energizes me, such as an artist's curse and compulsion.
Tidings to you. Time and tide wait for no man. Thank you. tidings to you. Time and tide wait for no man.
Who'd have thought those bleating bastards would go and find religion, eh? Now, there's nothing quite so sure to spoil a man's appetite than an ecclesiastical debate come supper time. Yet this goatman god, this Aberarth, seems fair determined to mix his morsels with his spiritual enlightenments. To put no finer point on it, when the goatman find him a soft pink human or two as divine sacrifice, he eats them, meat, soul and all. Well, that's what the legends say.
Good tidings to you.
Good work clearing another path through Axiom Prison. I'm starting to think those stories I've heard about you might be true. Stay sharp out there. With the road to the Frisian forest clear again, I trekked through to the forests beyond to see if the strangeness we're seeing on the coast is also happening inland. What I saw nearly froze my heart solid. The animals there, poor wretches, overtaken by some sort of parasite. As close as I can reckon, they're like termites, burrowing into flesh and mind instead of wood. If I'm right, there'll be a nest somewhere, and a queen. If you can find it, destroy it. Those parasites aren't something we want to see around here anytime soon. Stay sharp out there.
Humanity flourish. I have another deity in mind who could be persuaded to donate a little essence to your ongoing edification. Aberrath, a deranged old goat with a thirst for human souls, whose cloven hooves now stand astride the old prisoner's road. Have you ever tasted a soul, Beastler? No, I imagine not. The poets will speak of sweet souls, bitter souls, enlightened souls, and twisted souls. You know what most of them taste like, really. Regret, with a lingering aftertaste of should have known better. A renowned alchemist, eroded by his lust for distilled spirits, and not the alcoholic kind. Aberrath the Scholar King, dancing upon a stage of chemicals and fire. He used his knowledge to burn away the flesh so as to liquidate the life force within, a libation he consumed with both frequency and alacrity. It started with animals, goats specifically, and thus his own cruelty became his curse. The Scholar King became the Cloven One, quaffer of souls. Some say he turned to the dram of man in order to cure himself. I believe his thirst simply grew with his burgeoning immortality. And perhaps he still retains some of his scholarly nature, for he seemed fair determined to share his hard-won wisdom. He took himself a princess, a lovely thing from a local tribe, and 9 months later she gave birth to something rather unlovely. The Fawn, as wild and wicked as the shaggy god himself. Schooled in his father's ways, the Fawn would carry off many more virgins in his time. And thus, the race of goatmen found their footing. Remember, humanity needs us.
Good tidings. Time and tide wait for no man.
Let's deal. Don't drink the water.
Thank you.
We may just discover the truth of this world.
nearby. So, Einar will go feed the ones we caught.
What are you doing? God drag you to damnation if you're gonna stand by and let this happen to me, to us! Because believe me, the Brian King has far greater appetites than one nothing of a girl from Oriath. It doesn't matter what he'll do to me now. It's what he'll do to Rayclast. Yet there's hope. There's always hope. If only you can reach Mervale's cave. If only...
Souls were hard enough to come by without that parched old goat drinking his fill. You have done humanity a noble service.
Ah, and now I stink of goat.
Hello.
Thank you.
tidings to you. I'd wait for no man. Good tidings to you. tidings to you.
The old goat's turned up his tootsies, has he? Oh, wait! I feel a poem coming on.
Through the bleating flock, our exile did wade. Over hoof and horn and goat blood sprayed. Until, at last, an audience with old King Billy, or the Cloven One, or Aberroth, and other names just as silly. Dine with me, friend, old Billy did growl. Feed me your soul, feed me it now. Our exile just smiled and gutted that goat, so that not one more soul would get stuffed down his old throat.
Honestly, you wouldn't believe how hard it is to find a good rhyme for goat exile.
Still alive, are we? Stay sharp out there.
What now?